Good evening, everyone. My name is John Hughes. I'm the music director of Chicago Master Singers. Welcome to another session of CMS University. I'm glad you're all in attendance at class this evening, and I hope that you all will participate throughout the presentation tonight. Now, the way you can do that if you're watching this live on Monday evening is make sure you're logged into YouTube, and then join the conversation going on the right-hand side of your screen in the chat window. You'll see people commenting and talking amongst themselves throughout the evening, and you'll even be able to ask me a question if one pops into your mind. I just ask that you start those with three or four question marks in a row so I can kind of quickly see what's intended for me, and I'll put them up on the screen and answer them as time allows. But all are welcome to participate either amongst yourselves or by asking me a question. So please do that. It makes it more fun and enjoyable. Our topic tonight is all about the music of John Alden Carpenter, a composer who was really quite well known in the early part of the 20th century and has some pretty significant connections to Chicagoland. He and I actually were born in the same town, Parkridge, Illinois, a small suburb, at least geographically. And that's how I first became aware of Carpenter. But I, even until I recently, when I was working on this presentation, I really didn't know much about his music aside from a few art songs. So this has been something I've really enjoyed learning about, and I'm excited to share it with you. So just a few things to get us started here. There's a picture of John Alden Carpenter, born in 1876, died in 1951. Now, before we actually get into John Alden Carpenter himself, I think it's important that we understand just kind of his lineage, which is interesting in and of itself. So first of all, he was very interested in genealogy and traced his family roots very far back, including to a member of parliament from 1323, so very far back. And most famously, the very famous pilgrim John Alden, who was a crew member of the Mayflower and the longest surviving signer of the Mayflower Compact and his namesake, right? So he definitely came from very sophisticated family. We'll see throughout, one author described his family as part of the Illinois gentry. So we see kind of aristocratic influences on Carpenter. And it really starts with just his family tree here. Now his father, maybe more directly, was a very successful businessman. He started this company, George B. Carpenter, which was a marine outfitter. It sold, you know, sails and ropes for ships and bells, lights. And you can actually go, if you search George B. Carpenter Company, now there's whole websites devoted to their merchant marine equipment. So very important person. He was not only successful in business, but was very, gave back to the community. He was the first village president of Park Ridge. So just a little history about this little town here. He originally, the name of the town was Pennyville, and there's actually a nice restaurant in town here named after that original name, Pennyville. And then eventually the village changed its name to Brickton because of all the bricks that were made in Park Ridge for Chicago, right? And then finally, its name was changed to Park Ridge because it's on a ridge. George B. Carpenter, John Alden's father, was the one who actually suggested that name change. So very influential person in town. And actually there's a school, a public school in Park Ridge named after him, the Carpenter School. It's right off of Toohey, there just north of the community center, if you're familiar with Park Ridge. So really kind of prominent citizens in this town. His mother was also very important to him and to his musical development. She was a musician herself. She played organ and sang at the local Congregational Church. And again, there's kind of a connection there between the Pilgrims, right, like John Alden was, and the Congregational Church, which traces its lineage back to the Pilgrims. But she was very active throughout Chicagoland. She sang in the Chicago Apollo Club. She co-founded the Chicago Amateur Club. She even hosted the Swedish Nightingale herself, Jenny Lind, when she visited Chicago. So very well connected. Probably most importantly for our purposes tonight, that she was John Alden's first piano teacher. She started him off when he was 5 years old, and as he got older, he eventually studied with other people. But she really passed on her love of music to her son. He said this about her, I'll let you read it for yourself, but he was very, very much a lover of music, right? John Alden talks about this, the word amateur, which isn't used in a pejorative way, but is used at, when you think about the root of the word, amor, meaning love. She had a real true love for music, and that she passed that on to her son. And I think that's really significant. So a little bit about the composer himself. You can see him pictured here as a child. He was born in Park Ridge in late February 1876. And the Carpenter family moved to Park Ridge after the Great Chicago Fire of 1871. They had lost their home in the fire. And at the time, Park Ridge was really kind of a far-flung outpost from the city, right? So only 400 residents at the time, which is a far cry from the 38,000 who live here now. So it was very separate and really felt rural in a way. And I read that their house, it no longer exists, but is was in between the intersection of Toohey and Northwest Highway, kind of right across the street from the Pickwick Theater at that Six Corners intersection, if you're familiar with it. And their home was there and was very elegant. It had imported furniture, the wallpaper was from England, it had many, many servants. So again, we kind of see what one author described, that their family enjoyed the Illinois gentry lifestyle. Now their home in Park Ridge was their primary home during summer and spring. And then they maintained a second home in Chicago for the fall and winter months. So again, we see this very much as kind of their Park Ridge home as a retreat from the busy city life into kind of more relaxation and leisure time. All four of the Carpenter sons, who you can actually see, I think three of them here in this picture, all four of them went to Harvard University. And so that's, again, kind of showing their status in society at the time. At Harvard, Carpenter studied with a very famous teacher, John Knowles Payne, and he was very, very active. He said he was the president of the Harvard Glee Club. He composed music for the Hasty Pudding plays, so he was very just active and social, right? After he graduated in 1897, he returned back to Chicago, where he spent the rest of his life, and he went into his father's business. Now, much like Charles Ives, who was a very famous composer who also worked in insurance, and I believe the company that Charles Ives worked for is still in existence. Just like that, Carpenter was a vice president at his father's company until he retired in 1936. So very much active in the business world, but maintained a very high level and serious attention to composition. We know that in 1906, so when he was in his career, he went to Rome for 3 months in the summer of 1906 to study with the great English composer Sir Edward Elgar. He also maintained a studio with the great German music theorist Bernhard Zien in Chicago until Zien died in 1912. So he really kind of wore two hats at the same time. Now, one thing about Carpenter that you have to understand is that he was a very serious and very intellectual person, but that doesn't mean he was boring. His music is very playful, and he was very social and kind of outward facing. So you'll see here on the slide, I won't read it all to you, but he was a member of a number of clubs. He was a very philanthropic and served in leadership roles on several boards. He was awarded many awards and honorary degrees, including from Harvard, Northwestern, the University of Wisconsin. And I think most importantly, for our purposes, it's important to note that his papers are collected both at the Library of Congress and the Newberry Library here in Chicago. To me, this really demonstrates that he was really well respected during his life, and that when he died, he was so highly thought of that they established these collections at such prestigious institutions. This demonstrates one thing about history that even though we might not be all that familiar with John Ar Alden Carpenter today, I've never heard his music live aside from art songs, which he is well known for today. But a lot of his bigger works are kind of in the history books, so to speak. It shows that our perspective is maybe flawed because at the time he really was a significant composer, and I hope tonight to maybe shed some light on him for you too. So let's talk a little bit about his musical style. Now, one thing that I found to be very interesting was when I started researching Carpenter as someone who's interested in my hometown of Park Ridge and obviously music. I expected to find more choral music, considering he was once president of the Harvard Glee Club, one of the oldest university choirs in the country. And it turns out he really only wrote two pieces for chorus. He didn't write much else, and I've actually exchanged a few emails with the main scholar on Carpenter, Howard Pollack. And Mr. Pollack, or Dr. Pollack, didn't really have a good suggestion about why Carpenter didn't write more choral music, except that it might have kind of fallen out of style in the early 20th century. There just wasn't a lot of octavo length choral pieces being written. That was focus was more on instrumental music and ballet, and we see that in Carpenter's output a lot. So when we're talking about Carpenter's pieces tonight, we're going to be listening to both some art songs and some instrumental works, and then one of his choral pieces, just to let you know. Okay, so one thing to realize about Carpenter, and again, I'm not going to read this full quote to you, but one thing to realize about Carpenter is even though he was very cosmopolitan and studied with Bernhard Zint, this German theorist, studied with Elgar, an English composer, but he studied with him in Rome. So he was very kind of cosmopolitan in that way. There's a sense of kind of intrinsic Americanism in Carpenter's writing. And this quote from Virgil Thompson, who was also a composer at this time, is basically saying, Stravinsky and Schoenberg moved here from Europe. And no matter how long they were here in the United States, their compositional essence was still formed by Europe. It's the same in the opposite sense of Carpenter. No matter how much he studied, no matter how much he integrated of European styles into his music, his Americanism continues to show through. And that's a good thing on both sides. So we see this really kind of eclectic style of Carpenter, his Americanism being the influence of jazz and popular music. There's a lot of whimsy and kind of fantastical things, some sentimentality about the past, right, which is a very kind of American idea. And a lot of humor. So we'll see that all tonight. I think his music sounds very, very similar to that of Gershwin in terms of its integration of popular styles with it. We also, though, see Carpenter take things from French Impressionism, like someone like Ravel or Debussy, And then Germanic form, which he got from Sint. So really a mismatch of things that all do come together and work really nicely. So the first piece we're going to listen to is probably Carpenter's most famous art song today, When I Bring to You Colored Toys. I have heard this performed many times in my vocal career. And this actually comes from Carpenter's, one of his five song cycles. So he wrote a significant amount of art song in his life. Five song cycles plus probably two dozen standalone art songs. This one is from a song cycle called Gitanjali, which is all settings of the West Bengal poet Tagore. Now, Tagore's influence and kind of his Hinduism and his kind of spiritual approach to the world very much appealed not only to Carpenter, but to a lot of people in the early 20th century. People were very interested in Eastern thought. And so it is really important to a lot of composers that were exploring texts from this part of the world. Now, this song cycle is really, really important. And actually, the CSO commissioned Carpenter to orchestrate it for them in 1914 to be performed with a soloist. So it's not just a pretty song with a piano, right? This was really popular at the time. So we're going to listen to a piano version or art song with singer and piano of When I Bring to You Colored Toys.
A play of colors on glass, on water, and why flowers are painted in tints when I give color toys to you, my child. I truly know why there is music in leaves, and why waves send their chorus of voices to the heart of the listening air. When I sing to make you secretly filled with sweet juice. When I bring sweet things to
So you can hear a little of that French impressionism at the end, right? With that kind of wash of sound. I think it's a lovely way to end such a pretty piece. The next one is where you'll really hear the Gershwin comparison. And this is from a piece called Crazy Cat, 1921. And this is what Carpenter called a jazz pantomime. It's really his second ballet. And it's based on a newspaper cartoon strip, right? You might remember those back in the good old days of a real newspaper. And in this, the dancers actually wore black, white, and gray costumes that then kind of reference that newspaper. This was first performed actually in Chicago, December 23rd, 1921, and was very, very popular throughout the early 20th century, even though we don't know it quite as much today. Although you'll see the performance we're gonna listen to is very recent and is by very prestigious ensembles. So we see this music does endure, even if we're not all super familiar with it today. But we're gonna listen to just one short movement of Crazy Cat, the presto movement, fast. I love that piece. Okay, we're gonna jump to the next piece, which grew right out of Crazy Cat. Sounds a little different, but it's called Skyscrapers, 1924, so a few years later. And the story behind it is that the founder of Ballet Russe, Serge Diaghilev, heard Crazy Cat and was very impressed by it, and then asked Carpenter to write another ballet, his third ballet, on American life. And here in Skyscrapers, Carpenter tries to capture kind of the city of broad shoulders, right? Chicago was known for the first city with major skyscrapers, right? So that's kind of what Carpenter is trying to catch and distill into this piece. And again, this piece really, it's maybe a little bit more serious sounding than Crazy Cat, which is kind of playful, right? Cartoonish. Here we see him maybe approach it as a little bit more dissonant, but trying to capture that hustle and bustle of a city in the way that a composer like Bernstein or Irving Berlin or Gershwin would try to do in the same sorts of ways. Now, Carpenter uses some eclectic instruments here, right? So he uses a banjo, he uses xylophone, saxophone, things that we don't normally associate with orchestral pieces, but he makes them work. And he, again, integrates both modernism and kind of more formal approaches to music with popular styles such as blues and ragtime. Now, even though this piece was very much based on Chicago, It actually premiered at the Met in New York. So very, very important piece. And you can see here, you know, the previous recording we listened to was by the BBC Concert Orchestra. This one is by the London Symphony Orchestra. So it does show you his reach was and is still pretty profound and international even. So we'll listen to just a couple minutes of the beginning of Skyscrapers. I'll leave you hanging there, but listen to this piece. It's about 20 minutes long, but it's really, really interesting, and I hope you'll check it out on YouTube or wherever you get your recordings these days. The last piece that we're going to talk about this evening is his kind of one surviving choral work, which is in a short oratorio called Song of Faith. Now, this, I say it's kind of his one known choral work today, although I still, having worked on this for a couple months, have yet to track down a score of this. It's been quite difficult. So that might be an obstacle, right? When we're trying to learn about Carpenter and his scores aren't available for whatever reason, it makes it difficult to be able to perform it or learn about it. So an obstacle to overcome. Now, this piece was written in 1932 for the bicentennial of George Washington. And it's a chorus or a cantata for four-part chorus with children singing, narrator and orchestra. And Carpenter wrote the text himself, but is really quoting Washington and Whitman in it. So it's very, again, we see this very Americana. It has a very political purpose, talking about the legacy of George Washington as our first president, someone who resigned, right, who didn't want to be president for life, which was very significant, right? But it's not overtly political. It is, he kind of approaches America with kind of a religious ideal of what this nation's promise is. And it's very interesting when you think about what was happening in the world in 1931. So through this, he really traces the development of the United States from the Revolution, George Washington, through the modern day and this idea of the American dream, which we're all still pursuing. And, you know, typical of Carpenter, even though it's a serious piece, he does add a little whimsy and nostalgia by kind of referencing Yankee Doodle throughout. So a little nod to the Revolutionary age as well. This premiered on a radio broadcast in February of the bicentennial year, 1932. And this, by the way, on the left-hand side is some stamps that were produced. So this was a big kind of effort to commemorate the bicentennial of Washington. Now, Carpenter said this about the work and kind of his goal. He said, "It is from that," meaning the selfless integrity of Washington's character, "that we inherit the great American dream, the dream which has sustained us through our storms and trials. The whole world is beset by a dangerous psychology of defeat, and it is for our country now to raise its eyes to in the faith of its founders and lead the way out. If my song of faith can succeed in lighting one single candle of reaffirmation, I shall be content." So you can see his goals are very idealistic for this piece, much more than political. Now, as I mentioned, it was performed first on the radio, and in the days after that, it was performed in many concert halls across the country, including Koussevitzky in Boston. It was performed in Chicago in that same February, Indianapolis, throughout the world. It really became a significant piece. Now, Carpenter frequently would appear as the narrator, and he would do this offstage and unannounced. He did it both in a performance in Chicago as well as on the album recording that we're going to listen to tonight. And a funny story I read was that a critic was reviewing this new album in 1932 and loved the piece, thought it was great, and said, you know, why didn't they find someone with a more kind of present voice to really show the nobility of Washington? And of course, he didn't know that it was Carpenter himself who was playing that narrator, and of course was embarrassed and changed his review once he heard that. But that's what we'll be listening to tonight, so you'll get to hear John Alden Carpenter's voice yourself. Now, during World War II, Song of Faith really became well known. It was broadcast in London over the radio in 1941, and toward the end of World War II, in August of 1944, it was performed as part of the 15th annual Chicago Music Festival at Soldier Field. Here, there were 90,000 people in attendance and 10,000 people in the chorus and orchestra that performed this. It's remarkable, right? You know, when you just think of the sheer numbers, especially this day and age when, you know, a gathering of five is verboten, to have, you know, 90,000 people singing Carpenter's and enjoying Carpenter's music, and we don't even know about this piece today, right? It's a shame in a way, and it makes me want to learn more. Now, one of the reasons that we might not know about this, and this was suggested by another scholar, is that this piece by Aaron Copland, another great kind of American voice, A Lincoln Portrait, came about in 1942, kind of honoring the contributions of Abraham Lincoln, one of our other great presidents, and that this A Lincoln Portrait has taken the place of Song of Faith on kind of patriotic concert programs. So that might be part of the reason for the decline in the performance of this piece. Anyway, we're going to listen to two kind of short sections of Song of Faith. Sometimes it's referred to as Hymn of Faith, so you might see that on the video here. We're going to listen to a little bit of the kids singing, and you can hear little hints of Yankee Doodle. And then I'll skip forward, and we'll hear just a little bit of Carpenter speaking. And you'll see he does have maybe a little bit of a flat affect here, but a little bit of Song of Faith. Thank you.
by commending the interests of our dearest country to the protection of Almighty God.
So I apologize for the poor audio quality and kind of the flat affect of the narrator, but that's all we have, right? There aren't a ton of recordings of Carpenter's music, so something maybe the field can pick up. But I hope that that gives you a little taste of his kind of one surviving choral cantata, Song of Faith. Now, I was looking at the chat while we were listening to that, and I saw people mentioning some of these other works by Carpenter that are well known. And I don't have any good answers for you about, did Gershwin specifically know about this piece or Bernstein? But it is pretty clear that they were all working in kind of the same direction, if you will. So a little bit about Carpenter. If you're interested in learning more, I invite you to check out, there are a couple very good sources here. First of all, if you're just interested in learning more about their influence as a family in Park Ridge, there's a nice little paragraph or two on the Park Ridge City website, so you can check that out. The Joan O'Connor book, a biobibliography, is really useful if you're interested in kind of reading what newspapers were saying about Carpenter's works when he was alive. So this references reviews of specific pieces. So that's very nice. The two books by Howard Pollack, who is a musicologist, I believe, at Rice University. These books are the same. So the first one, published by the Smithsonian Institute Press in 1995. In 2001, the University of Illinois Press reprinted it under a new title, but they're the same book. Anyway, these two, whichever one you want to read, are very, very well done. They're very good biographies. You don't have to be a musical expert to read them and get some enjoyment out of them, but really, really fine job of compiling a ton of information about this composer that we really kind of have let slide too far to the back burner, in my opinion. And it has lots of good anecdotes and information. So I really recommend that book, whichever version you want to get. I hope that this has been a fun way to spend an hour or so on a Monday evening. Thank you for joining me. I hope that you'll come back next week when we'll do our third Inside the Score session, all on Fauré's Requiem. And I know that's one of my very favorite pieces, and I'm looking forward to sharing some information with you about it and listening to parts of it as well. If you haven't registered for that yet, please do so using the Eventbrite link in the video description below. I hope too that you will like this video. I've seen a few thumbs up come in, and subscribe to our channel. Share it with a friend or family member who might be interested. And remember too, you can always watch any session, the recording, on our YouTube channel. So maybe some of you are watching this not on Monday evening. If so, that's great. Or if you've missed any, you can always go back too. But check it out. There's a lot of great information there. Finally, we are accepting donations to support this initiative during this difficult time for arts organizations. If you're able to donate, please check out these links. They're all in the video description below, and we do very much appreciate your generosity. All right, our moment of Zen tonight, our Choral Candy, is one of my very favorite pieces, and frankly, I'm surprised that it's taken me this long to play this piece for you. This is a piece by the great Norwegian composer Knut Nystedt, and it's a piece called O Crux. And you can see the text here. And this is a good example of a piece that's very beautiful that isn't pretty at the beginning, at least. It's quite dissonant at the start, and then it all kind of melts, and it kind of in alignment with the text, what's happening in the text. And it goes from very dissonant to very serene. And I just love it. And the recording I found, I'm stunned by. I think it's really, really fine singing by a small group. It's called Vaktet Hanover, so from Germany. I was not familiar with them until I was looking for a recording of this piece, and it blew me out of the water. So I hope you enjoy this lovely piece and such a really fine performance in a beautiful, beautiful architecture and acoustic. So without further ado, here's Au Croux.
Thank you.
one of the scariest soprano parts at that ending, but beautiful piece. I hope you've enjoyed this, and I hope you'll join me next week. Enjoy the sunshine, and take care. Until next week, have a good night.